this age that thrives on sharing information. I read this statistic. It was baffling. On Google, now, y'all don't realize the struggle was real back in the day in the 90s when I was a kid and y'all were being born. I had to get information. You didn't Google it. You didn't Google it. You went into the living room where the one phone was, okay? The one phone in your whole house, and it had a cord connected. Okay, and if you wanted to make a private phone call, you have to get the phone and hold the button so that the call wouldn't start, and walk and pull the cord in to the bathroom and then close the door so that you get on the phone and just breathe with your girlfriend. What's up, girl? And then if somebody else got on the line, Mom, I'm on the phone. Stop trying to spit some game. But you had to call 411 for information. Now we just Google stuff. We just ask Siri, Alexa, you know? They're there for us. But I saw this 400,000 Google searches happen every second. 3.5 billion searches a day. 1.2 trillion searches a year. That's a lot of information. And you would think with more information being shared, the more intimate our connections would be. With more information being shared, greater information, perhaps there would be greater intimacy. But that's not what we see. Because information and intimacy are not the same things. But in our culture, we have confused information with intimacy. And I think that that's what the enemy of our souls desires, is to get us to settle for an information-based relationship with God, because it gives us a sense of knowing God and being known by Him without ever being in an intimate, connected relationship with Him. That's what strikes me about this exchange at this well, this woman having this conversation with Jesus. I've heard this story preached so many times, and I've read it several times, but this last week, looking over this scripture, something really stuck out to me. This woman had a lot of information. She knew a lot. See, I always looked at her as just, you know, a sinner who did not quite understand who God was, what He had done, and what He was doing. And yet, that's not what the scripture bears to be true at all. She is familiar with the Jewish customs. She understands that Jesus was a Jew. She knows that the well that they're standing at was built by her ancestor, Jacob. She recognizes Jesus operating in the prophetic. She knows where her ancestors worship. She points to a mountain where they worship. She knows that the Messiah is coming. She has all this information, but she uses the information to deflect rather than to engage. She uses the information as a barrier to keep Jesus out when Jesus was trying to engage her in the intimate details of her lives. And I think that it could be the case for many of us in this room. We have been inundated with information about God, but we still don't recognize Jesus. You can clap just so it's not awkward for you. Like this woman, we may know a lot about church, been at a lot of church. We know a lot about religion. We may know a lot about philosophy. We may know a lot about history. We may even know a lot about God, but we still don't recognize Jesus when He walks into the room. But it does not stop Jesus from recognizing her. See, she thought she was going to the well just to get water that day, a life source, a cleansing agent, something to sustain her temporarily in the physical, on the surface. But Jesus saw what she really came there for. Not for water from a well, but water from the well. The eternal life source. The soul cleansing agent. Something to sustain her eternally in the spiritual, in the deep end of her heart. This is what I am imploring us to do tonight. We have to stop trying to drink from a well and start drinking from the well. A well will run dry. The well will fill you up until you overflow. A well will let you date them, spend your money, waste your time, confuse your mind, and use your body. But the well will satisfy your soul in your deepest places. A well may fill up your bank account, give you the platform you want, get you the whip that you want, get you the status you crave. But the well will store up treasures for you in heaven that will not corrupt and will not depreciate in value. I just came to tell somebody, and I feel like preaching for my last 5 minutes on this stage. You think you came to a well tonight, but that's not how I see it. The well came to you. Oh, you ought to put your hands together and lift your voice, because you couldn't get good enough. You couldn't get rich enough. You couldn't get popular enough. You couldn't get redeemed enough on your own, in your own merit, with your own performance. You needed Jesus to come to you, and he did. He extended his grace and his mercy toward you when we least deserved it. The Bible frames it like this: while we were yet sinners, God demonstrated his great love for us. Woo! You ain't gonna help your boy? That's good. Fire emoticon. It ain't real if it ain't got an emoji. But the cool thing about this exchange is that she had information, but Jesus had better information. See, she had old information. Jesus came to update her. Hey.